CIET NCERT presents curriculum based series Dhwani Shala. So let's join in Dhwani Shala class 7.
Hello learners of class 7. How are you all? I hope you are all fine. Learners, today we will do the poem from your class 7 book Honeycomb. I am Meenu Gupta, mentor teacher from Directorate of Education, Delhi. With me is Mridul, our learner of the day. Hello Mridul.
Hi.
Mridul, you and I will together read, understand and enjoy the poem of the day, The Shed by Frank Flynn. Before we begin, let us listen to this tune carefully. Have you heard the tune carefully, Mridul?
Yes.
How do you feel on hearing this tune?
Thrill, fear and suspense.
Great words. Thrill, fear, suspense. So, our poem today is based something on the similar feelings. Learners and Mridul, have you ever seen a shed somewhere?
Yes, ma'am, in the fields. Garden.
Great. Learners, this poem is regarding a shed. A shed is a simple structure used for storage. It could be in a garden, in a field. We can store anything in it, from tools, to hay, to animals, or it can be a workshop. It could be open or it could be roofed as well. So, there could be various kinds of shed. A garden shed, a tool shed, a bicycle shed. There can be many more types of shed. Mridul, can you name any shed?
Tin shed or cow shed.
Tin shed and cow shed. Very good. Similarly, you can also name a few types of shed as you have seen. All the examples would be correct. Great work. But remember, a word can be used in various manners in English. Similarly, the word shed here is used as a noun, but it can be used as a verb as well. For example, the trees shed leaves in autumn. Or another example, when you cry, what does your mother say? Don't shed tears, right? Here, in both the examples, shed is being used as a verb because it shows some action, either of the leaves or of the tears. But it is not a concern here, because here the poet is using the word shed as a noun. As we move ahead towards the poem, let us plan our objectives. Here are the objectives of this interaction. Learners, at the end of this lesson, you will be able to read aloud and recite the poem with correct pauses and rhythm. Understand the poem and its meanings. Interpret the poem, connecting with our life and experiences. Learn the literary devices like simile, metaphor, rhyming scheme. Learners, just tell me, what are the words that can be used both as noun and the verb called? Mridul, do you know?
Sorry, ma'am, I don't know.
No problem. Such words are called homonyms. So, the words that have similar spelling and pronunciation but are used in a different meaning or context are called homonyms. Mridul, let us begin by reading out the poem first. I'll read the poem first and then when I ask you, you will read the poem. Fine? So we are beginning with a poem. There is a shed at the bottom of our garden with a spider's web hanging across the door. The hinges are rusty and creak in the wind. When I am in bed, I lie and I listen. I'll open that door one day. There is a dusty old window around the side with three cracked panes of glass. I often think there is someone staring at me each time that I pass. I will peep through that window one day. My brother says there is a ghost in the shed who hides under the rotten floorboards. And if I ever dare to set foot inside, he'll jump out and chop my head. But I will take a peep one day. I know that there isn't really a ghost. My brother tells lies to keep the shed for his den. There isn't anyone staring or making strange noises. And the spider has long gone from his web. Since I don't know when, I will go into that shed one day soon, but not just yet. Mridul, as you must have heard the poem, the way I recited it, did you feel something about it?
Yes, ma'am, there was some suspense in it.
Yes, there is suspense in it. Now, the poem, The Shed by Frank Flynn, is about a speaker's fear. Here, the speaker is a child. We don't know a boy or a girl. It could be any. But he's a child who is curious about the shed in the corner of his or her garden. But he's afraid to go there. You can think he can go and check what is there in the shed. No, he's afraid. The poem deals with how and what a child thinks over the information received from his or her brother. It is about a playful rivalry among siblings. Siblings could be a boy or a girl, or a brother or a sister, or two brothers or two sisters, it could be any. Now, let us repeat from where we began. What is a shed?
A shed is a temporary structure built to shelter something. There are many types of shed, but we don't go there often.
Very good. So, Mridul, can you think of a place where you don't want to go and why?
An empty dark building. Why? Because I am afraid of who might be there.
Great. Right. We all are afraid of going into an empty or a dark building, any abandoned building where others don't go. Why? Because we are afraid. There might be some people there, some bad elements or some insects or some animals. So we all are afraid. Now, let us continue with the poem paragraph wise. Now, Mridul, can you help us read the poem? Please read stanza 1.
Yes, ma'am. Stanza 1. There is a shed at the bottom of our garden with a spider's web hanging across the door. The hinges are rusty and creak in the wind. When I am in bed, I lie and I listen. I will open that door one day.
Great. So Mridul has brought some feelings into the stanza. Can you feel the poem? So there is a shed at the bottom of the garden. So where is the shed? It is at one corner of the garden with a spider's web hanging across the door. So you must have all have seen a spider web. In a place where you don't often clean or you don't often go, there are always cobwebs that are hanging there. The hinges are rusty. What's rusty? A thing that is covered with rust, which is corroded, which is old. And creak in the wind. Creak is make a very sharp noise when you try to open this. You all must have seen in your homes the door that you don't open very often is always making noise when you try to open it. So what do your mothers do? They oil it and then the door becomes smooth. So similarly, that door also creaks when there is any wind or anybody would try to open it. When I am in bed, I lie and listen. So when do you go to bed? At night. And at night, everything is silent. So every small sound, you will listen to it very carefully. So he's scared. Whenever he listens to that sound, he gets scared. I'll open that door one day. but he's thinking ki someday he'll open that door. That door will not remain closed forever. So the poem opens with the description of the shed, the physical description. How there is a shed which is in the corner of a garden. It has rusty hinges and makes creaking sound when the wind passes through it. The speaker thinks about scary things at the bedtime. He gets scared at night because probably he is sleeping alone. So whenever he hears to the strange noises, he gets scared. He's afraid. But he has a very strong desire to open that door. It could be she also. Please don't mind my saying he or she. I'm just using he because the poet is Frank. What a beautiful imagery. Can you think? Now you can close your eyes and think. Can you imagine a empty abandoned building you have seen, or the store of your house, or any room that is kept locked and opened after a long time? So it would give some similar feeling like the poet is feeling. Now let us read aloud the second part. Mridul will help us out. Mridul, will you please read stanza 2?
Yes ma'am, sure. There is a dusty old window around at the side with three cracked panes of glass. I often think there is someone staring at me each time that I pass. I'll peep through that window one day.
Okay, he's managing to scare me. Okay, so let's continue. There is a dusty old window. So the window, because nobody goes there, it's covered with dust. And the glass of that window is cracked. So there might be many panes in that single window, as you must have seen in various windows at your place. So three of those panes are cracked, broken. And whenever the poet passes near that window, he feels somebody is looking at him. Staring is looking constantly without blinking. And because everything is dark inside, he can't see who is exactly is there, whether there is somebody or not. But he's feeling scared. I'll peep through that window one day. But again, he's gathering courage. That place will not remain unexplored. He will go and check that place one day at least. He'll look through that window. He'll peep through that window. He'll look in. Ki what is going inside. So, the shed has old dusty windows and cracked panes. The stanza carries forward the description of the shed. How it was in such a poor condition, uncared, broken. The speaker thinks that someone is staring at him or her each time he is passing through that window. That all could be fear in his mind. Because the shed has been closed for so long, would there be somebody at that place? I don't think so. What do you think, Mridul? Would there be someone?
Maybe.
Maybe. So we don't know. Maybe. But it happens. Like once we go to any dark place where we can't see, we get afraid of someone hiding there or attacking us from the dark, or even ghost might be there. We don't know. Can you imagine such a place in your head? The condition the shed may be in, the place how we are talking about it. So can you feel the poem? So let us move on to the next stanza now. Mridul?
Yes ma'am. My brother says there is a ghost in the shed who hides under the rotten floorboards. And if I ever dare to set foot inside, he will jump out and chop off my head. But I will take a peek one day.
Great. So, even the brother is now reinforcing his fear. He is saying, my brother says there is a ghost in the shed. And that ghost is hiding where? Under the rotten floorboards. What does rotten? It's in a very bad condition. Poor. Floorboards are the boards that cover the floor. It could be wooden. So, if he ever dares to set the foot inside, that is, if he ever enters the shed, that ghost will come out and cut off his head. So, this third stanza shows how afraid the child is. His or her brother has told him or her about the ghost who has been hiding under the floorboard. He was also told that if he dared to enter it, the ghost would jump out and cut off his head. So this is that scary atmosphere that has been built up over the three paragraphs. They have brilliantly described how there might be a ghost in that shed. Now, do you think there might be a ghost? Have you ever seen a ghost? We haven't. I haven't at least. But we all have heard stories about ghosts, how a dark abandoned building, people have encountered ghosts. We actually don't know whether there are such ghosts really or they are a figment of their own imagination, their own fear. But again, let us see what happens next. Now, Mridul, can you continue with stanza 4, please?
Yes, sure. I know that there isn't really a ghost. My brother tells lies to keep the shed for his den. There isn't anyone staring or making strange noises, and the spider has been gone from his web. Since I don't know when, I'll go into that shed one day soon, but not just yet.
Great. Now, you will see there is a sudden change of tune, the way the speaker is speaking. He says, "Ki, I know there isn't really a ghost." For three paragraphs, he has been afraid there might be someone, there must be someone hiding there, or there might be ghost as his brother has told. But now he says ki he knows there isn't a ghost there. So probably his thinking skill is kicking in. So his brother tells lies to keep the shed for his den. What is a den? Den is our own secret place, our own hiding place where we love to do our favorite things, but we don't want others to see them. There isn't anyone staring or making strange noises. So he knows there because it's just an old building. There is no one hiding there or making noises. And the spider also is not there. Even the spider is not there. Forget the people. Even the spider is not there. Since I don't know when. So this shows that the child is growing up. That fear that was there in his mind since childhood that there was a ghost is gradually being overcome as he's growing up. I'll go into that shed one day soon. So he's gathering courage. Ki now he knows that there might not be any ghost. So he'll go into that shed, but not just yet. Why not just yet? Because probably he has not gathered the full courage to enter. He's slowly gathering, deciding he'll enter, but not just now, after some time. So, the concluding part of the poem says that speaker knows that there is no ghost in the building. He convinces himself or herself that the brother has told lies to keep that shed secret from him. To keep, probably his friends are coming over, playing there, so he doesn't want his brother or sister to enter. The speaker also knows that nobody is making strange noises and even the spiders have gone from that web. So, he or she is determined to enter the shed one day. The speaker is getting ready but is not completely ready to enter the shed. But he has made that decision that one day definitely he will get into that shed. This shows his curiosity. His practical mind that is taking over. He is trying to think rationally that there are actually no ghosts, so he should enter the building, the shed. There is a clear conflict in the mind of the speaker between what he thinks, what he wants, and what his or her brother has told him regarding the shed and the ghost. Can you feel? That what he is thinking? That there might be somebody. Then gradually he realizes there is not a ghost. What he wants? He wants to enter that shed. But what his brother has told? That there are ghosts in the shed. So there is a conflict between all these three ideas. So the poem ends on a very positive note. That he is gathering courage to enter the shed. But not just yet. So, it's something that is in the pipeline, in the agenda that he or she might enter the shed very soon. Fine learners, we have read the poem, discussed it. As you can gather from my explanation that in the first three stanzas, the speaker is scared or afraid of the ghost in the shed. He thinks about the strange voices that come from the shed and imagine someone is hiding but looking at him continuously. He believes in the ghost story told by his brother, but in the last stanza, his practical side takes over. The attitude changes completely. He realizes that there are no ghosts and decides to go inside the shed, but after some time. Now, here is a task for you. Now, I have been speaking for so long. Now, it's your turn to work. You will have to try to understand whether the following statements are true or false. Mridul will help me here, and you are supposed to think yourself whether the statement is true or false. Okay, first, Mridul, please pay attention. The poem is about a child and his or her brother.
True.
Okay, what do you think, true? But the title of the poem says the shed. You have to think very carefully. It can be true also, it can be false also. What we have to pay attention, where exactly the question is being asked. If your paragraph is among the first two paragraphs, then the answer is false. But if you are answering after the third or fourth paragraph, then the answer is true. So, please remember, the lines are always seen in context of where the lines are being placed. Alright, shall we continue? Second sentence, Mridul. The shed is located at the bottom of the garden.
True.
Oh, he's very quick. The first line, the shed is located at the bottom of the garden. True. Great. Sentence third. The shed is beautiful.
False.
Right. It's in a broken condition. Very bad, poor, dusted, rotten floorboards. So, the sentence is false. Next sentence. The child has gone into the shed.
Not yet false.
Not yet false. Very good, Mridul. See, he's paying attention. I hope you are also paying attention. Next sentence. He has decided to enter the shed.
True.
True. Very good, Mridul. Yes, he has decided that he will soon enter the shed. Next sentence. Now, this is again a tricky one. You need to pay attention. He knows that there are no ghosts in the shed. What do you think, Mridul? It is true or false?
It is a tricky question. It can be both.
It can be both. Now, he has understood what I have been speaking. Yes, it could be both true and false, depending on, again, where this question has been asked. We all remember that in context of poems, we often have reference to context questions in our examination. So, you need to pay attention where the question has been asked. If it is asked after first two paragraphs, this would be a false. And if it is asked after the fourth paragraph, it would be a true. Right? Did you enjoy doing it? At least I did. Mridul, did you enjoy?
Yes, sure.
He is not enjoying. He has been forced to study here. Okay? I hope you are not being forced. Mridul and learners, this is what we have learnt about the poem. Now, we have discussed the poem twice. I have read it once, discussed it paragraph wise. Now, you need to go and read the poem yourself. Why? To build clarity on the poem and see whether you are able to understand it completely. Next, let me ask you some questions. Let me check. Now, I have been speaking for so long. Now, it's your turn to work. Let me check. Have you understood the poem? So, question 1. Does the poet want to enter the shed? Mridul.
Yes, he wants to enter the shed, but he was not sure about it.
Yes, he wants to enter, but he is not sure. Why? Because he is afraid. So, is the poet afraid or is the poet curious or both? How is the poet feeling?
In the beginning of the poem, it was said that he is afraid, but he is curious too about the ghosts.
Yes. He is both, because every time he says that he is scared, he reinforces the idea that he will soon look into that window or enter that shed. So we know that the poet is both afraid and curious. It is very common to have a mixed feeling towards something. So similarly, the poet also has a mixed feeling. Okay, next question, Mridul. Does the poet think that the shed is dirty?
Yes, poet thinks the shed is dirty because he has used the words like dirty and rotten.
Yeah. Very good. See, he's paying attention. So if you are also paying attention, you'll get. We know that the shed is dirty because the poet often uses the words like dusty, rotten floorboards, cracked panes. Next question. But not just yet. If you can recognize, this is the last line of the poem. This suggests doubt, fear, hesitation, laziness. So what do you think? What could be the right answer?
It suggests hesitation as it ends with the three dots, showing the action continues.
Yes. Please pay attention to the punctuation in the poem. The poem ends with three dots. These three dots in literature are called ellipses, and which shows that this action will continue. So the poet is hesitating to go in, not just yet, but he has not totally given up. He will soon enter the shed. So he has taken it up very correctly. It shows hesitation. Very good, Mridul. We all know how to find rhyming words. I'll ask you a word from the poem, and then Mridul will help us to find out what would be the rhyming word for that word from the poem itself. Mridul, are you ready?
Yes, ma'am.
First word, glass.
Pass.
Shed.
Head.
Den.
When.
Great. So, he has picked up the right rhyming words. Now, let us move ahead. After rhyming words comes the rhyming scheme. But most of us forget how to check or make the rhyming scheme of the poem. What do we need to do is pay attention to the last word of each line in the poem. Now, let us have a look at the last word of the each line. Mridul, can you please read out the words from the first paragraph only? Last words only.
Garden, door, wind, listen, day.
Okay, great. So he has picked up the words garden, door, wind, listen, day. These are all the last words. Now, how do we decide the rhyming scheme? We start with A. Very good. Mridul has picked up. He has said, so we keep the first word. Garden would be always A. The next word is door. Does it sound similar to the garden? Yes or no?
No, not at all.
Not at all. So it would be B. Very good. For the third line, last word is wind. So does it sound similar to garden or door?
No.
No. So it would be C. Listen?
No.
No.
Again,
it would be D. Very good. Day?
It would be because it is not sounding similar
to any of the word which has been done before. So the rhyming scheme of this paragraph would be A B C D E. A B C D E. Now let us try with stanza 2. We have to remember that rhyming scheme of a poem may vary from stanza to stanza. It is not compulsory at all that all the stanzas in the poem will have the same rhyming scheme. Right? So, Mridul, will you help us find out the last words from stanza 2?
Yes, ma'am. Why not? Slide, glass, me, pass, day.
It's not slide, it's side. So, we have first word as side. It will begin with A. Glass. Does it match side?
No.
So it would be B. Me. Does it match anything, side or glass?
I don't think so.
So it would be C. Next word is pass. How does it sound like?
It is sounding like the second word.
Glass. So what was the alphabet assigned to glass? B. Next is day. Does it sound similar to anything?
No.
No. But we have come up till C. So it would be D. So the rhyming scheme of this paragraph would be A, B, C, B, D. A, B, C, B, D. I hope you have been able to understand how to make rhyming schemes for each stanza. Please remember that every stanza in the poem may or may not have the same rhyming scheme. So, I hope you can figure out the rhyming scheme for the remaining two stanzas. Thank you for paying attention to us. Happy learning. Goodbye.
You are just listening to curriculum-based programs, Dhwani Shala. Production assistants, Meenakshi Kukreti, Tanu Gupta and Jagbandhu Jana. Recorded by Bati Langlingdo and produced by Vandana Arimardhan. This program was brought to you by CIET NCERT, New Delhi, India.